All right, now you can hear me. Ooh. Maybe too loud. Let me start over. Good morning, family.
Good morning.
It's true, I've only been here 2 weeks, but yet already it feels like home. If we haven't met yet, I'm Pastor Eldon, and I've joined the staff to assist Pastor Dan in preaching, visitation, Bible studies, and pastoral counseling. My wife, Emily, is here with me this morning as well, and I introduce her to you. Emily's in the back there. Emily is in her third and final year of seminary at the Master's Institute and currently serving as an intern pastor at Redeemer Lutheran just across the river. So my wife, Emily, and I have four daughters, and here is a recent family picture of us. Well, that's not quite us. There we go. Our two oldest daughters, Jacqueline and Sonia, are married and each have a son and a daughter. So that gives us four wonderful grandchildren who are the most beautiful in the world, of course. Our third daughter, Naomi, lives in Brooklyn and works in New York and works in Manhattan. She's also part of a church plant in Brooklyn from her home church here in Minneapolis. And our youngest daughter, Helen, lives with us as she attends college and is pursuing a career in nursing. Now, I'm a second career pastor. God first called me to full-time ministry when I was in eighth grade, but it took me until I was in my 50s to attend seminary and become a pastor. There was a little tussling going on there. And always with God, he is persistent, but yet he's patient with us. So I spent 35 years in the electronics industry and retired from that in 2013. And through the years, I have had many encounters with God, with Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And one of the most dramatic of those was attending a Via de Cristo weekend in the 90s, where I came face to face with the love and the grace of God like never before and was radically changed. And oh, what a wondrous and adventurous journey it has been ever since then. And I doubt if I would even be here today if it hadn't been for that God encounter. But that's enough about me. Let's get on to the message for today. The title of the message is I Just Want to Be a Sheep. And it's based on Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now, Psalm 23 is one of the most popular and loved passages of the Bible. Right there in the top five with John 3:16 or Jeremiah 29:11 or Philippians 4:13 or Romans 8:28. Now, Psalm 23 portrays God as a lowly shepherd. And this is quite remarkable, for in biblical times, to be a shepherd was pretty much the bottom of the occupational food chain. This was the job that was left for the least desirable or the youngest son. Remember David, the youngest son of Jesse? He was a shepherd. And when Samuel came to Jesse's house to anoint the next king of Israel, David was off in the far pasture with the family sheep. David wasn't even considered by his father to be worthy to be considered as a candidate to be king. But yet, here we see the co-creator of all that exists, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, portrayed as a shepherd, a keeper of sheep. Now, this portrayal of God as a shepherd is not new in Scripture. Genesis 49, verse 24, God is referred to as the shepherd, the stone of Israel. Or in Psalm 80, verse 1, as the shepherd of Israel who will lead Joseph as a flock. Or Isaiah 40, verse 1, the Lord will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arms, as shown in this picture, with Jesus and the sheep. Or in John 10, where Jesus himself declares that I am the good shepherd. My sheep know me, and I know them. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the flock. So let's look at the sheep, the other main character in this psalm. Sheep, to put it bluntly, are really not very wise. You might even say stupid. They are herd animals that crowd together to the point of suffocating one another, while at the same time, they are very timid and easily frightened, while a low-flying bird going over the flock can cause them to panic and to scatter in all directions and get lost, which makes them easy prey for a predator. And sheep, for all practical purposes, are defenseless, with little or no means of protecting themselves. Yes, they do sometimes put their head down and charge to butt things around them, but that behavior is done mostly within the flock to define the order of dominance. So, when I talk about or define sheep, I'm out of order here. No wonder I'm lost. Now, a couple of dogs or wolves, because the sheep are so defenseless, could slaughter an entire flock in an evening if left unattended. Now, if one of the sheep should slip and fall and end up on its back, it would be stuck there, laying upside down without able to right itself if there wasn't some help from an outside source. So, once again, becoming an easy target for prey. So, as you can see, sheep are very needy animals. And this would have been very clear to David, for he was a shepherd and the son of a shepherd. Now, having identified and revealed the characters in the psalm, let's look at their relationship and interaction with each other to see what we can learn and apply to our own lives and relationships as well. Now, we'll only be looking at verses 1 and 2 today, as I only have 1 hour to speak. If you want to look at the rest of the psalm, I would encourage you to come and join us as we start a Wednesday morning Bible study at 10:30 in the morning, and that will be beginning on Wednesday, October 25th. Now, verse 1 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." David clearly defines here that God is the shepherd. And David doesn't just define God as a shepherd, but as my shepherd, David says. So if God is a shepherd and God is David's shepherd, then that makes David a sheep. Now, if David is a sheep, it follows that you and I are sheep as well. Now, based on what I just shared with the characteristics and nature of a sheep, you might get a little offended by that. That certainly doesn't define me. And on the surface, and in the physical sense, it would be true. We are not sheep. Or are we? In the physical realm, the shepherd sees to all the needs of the sheep under his care. And in a spiritual realm, which floods over into the physical realm, God is the source of meeting all of our needs. The air we breathe, the food we eat, the people we meet, is all orchestrated by God. John 15:5 tells us that apart from God, we can do no good thing. Now, I believe that one of the reasons that we struggle with being sheep is that our picture of the Good Shepherd is way too small, too cramped, and likely a bit too human. We tend to create God in our image, but he just doesn't fit that profile. And because of this struggle, we are unwilling to let God have control of our lives. Now, we likely do in part let God have control of part of our life, but God isn't looking for part-time disciples or part-time friends or part-time heirs of the kingdom of God. And that is because of who God is as our good shepherd. The shepherd wants for his sheep and his flock to have the very best. And the same is true for the good shepherd, our shepherd. God is jealous for you and me to have the very best. And that's what he desires to give to us. Psalm 84, verse 11 speaks to this. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. And the more we come to know God, and not just to know about God, but to know God, to really know who he is, his character, and his nature, the more we will gladly proclaim, like David, the Lord, he is my shepherd. We will want to be his sheep. Now, here are a couple questions to ask and discuss with Jesus and the Holy Spirit that we can use to kind of just sort out where we are at in our relationship as sheep with respect to the Good Shepherd. Do I really belong to him? Do I belong to the Good Shepherd? Or do I recognize the Good Shepherd right here with me? How well do I respond to his authority and acknowledge his ownership? And how much for freedom and fulfillment in my life do I have as a sheep of the Good Shepherd? Do I sense purpose and deep commitment because I am under the control of the Good Shepherd? I would encourage you this week to think about these questions. Just examine your relationship with Jesus Christ and with God the Father. Talk to him about that and take time to listen to his response. God does speak to us. He wants us to know his heart, and he enjoys talking with us and spending time with us. Let's go on to verse 2. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Here we see further how intimately the shepherd is involved with the sheep of his flock. Now, there are definite conditions that need to be met in order for a flock of sheep to be able to lay down and rest. And four primary ones of those are that we need to be free from the fears of externals, where the sheep need to be. The sheep need to be free from the friction that happens within the flock. They need to be free from the torment of flies and parasites. And they need to be free from hunger. Their bellies need to be full. I'm only going to look at the first two of those today, but we can look at more at another time. Now, a flock that is restless or agitated never does well. And the same is true of people, whether it be individuals or groups of people. Just as sheep need rest, we need rest as well. So the shepherd is constantly alert and on watch to eliminate disturbances that might cause the flock to not be at rest. It could be a predator, could be a stray dog, or it could be something as simple or innocent as a rabbit hopping out from under a bush. If there is concern amongst the flock, the sheep will not stand at attention, or they will stand at attention, ready to flee. And this is not a state of rest for the sheep. Now, a shepherd that is alert to his flock and knows them well will know that as he comes amongst the flock and walks around amongst them and with them, it brings a calm and a peace to the flock. They see his presence there and they feel protected. And this is also very true of the Christian life. There is just no substitute for the awareness that Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd, is with us. He's always available to us, and there is nothing like Christ's presence to melt away fear or panic and terror that can come from the unknown in our lives. Hear the promise of Colossians chapter 1, verse 27. Christ in you is that hope of glory. So we live in an ever-changing world filled with unknowns and unknown twists. Isn't it comforting to know that we have a never-changing God? A God who loves us, who cares for us, and is always available to us. One of the names for Jesus is Emmanuel, which means God with us. And because of Christ's presence with us, we can be at peace and rest, even in the midst of chaos all around us. Psalm chapter 4, verse 8 speaks to this. I will lie down and sleep in peace, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. Now, the second cause of unrest is tension and friction from within the flock itself. As with other animal society, there is an order of dominance in a flock of sheep, a pecking order, so to speak. But with sheep, it's called a headbutting order. And it will typically be an old cunning ewe that is domineering, that will be the boss of the flock. And she will maintain her position of dominance by putting her head down and ramming into other sheep to move them away from her preferred grazing or bedding grounds. And the butting process continues from there, right on down the line, from the most dominant to the least dominant. And this ongoing competition for position can cause unrest and tension within the flock. And interestingly enough, the higher in the pecking order, the butting order, a sheep is, the more tension they have in their life and the more unrest there is. Because they're constantly on guard to protect their position or to be moving up the butting order. And this edginess and irritability can cause them to lose weight and become prone to sickness. Now, once again, the presence of the shepherd in and amongst the flock brings calm and peace to them. When the sheep see the shepherd come and walk amongst them, they forget about their fighting and they look to him as their leader. Now, the behavior of the sheep is once again a graphic picture of the society we live in as well. There is competition amongst us to keep up with the Joneses, or today it might be keeping up with the Joneses' children. And within any business or office or family, community or organization, and yes, even church, among people groups, large and small, there is a competition to be that top dog, to fit in, to be seen, to be heard. And unfortunately, in the process, some people get hurt. There is a coveting to get what others have. And God knew that this was a problem for us, and so he included commandments against coveting in his top 10 list of how to have a happy and peaceful life. Now, Paul, writing to his understudy Timothy, explains in 1 Timothy 6:6, Godliness with contentment is great gain. So the more we are focused on what God says about us and who we are to him, the greater peace and contentment we have in our life. And this is so opposite of the message that we receive from the advertisements that we are bombarded with day in and day out, that try to convince us that the only way we can be happy is if we have the latest gadget or fashion wardrobe or car or beverage, and the list goes on and on and on. The solution for the disciple of Jesus Christ is knowing that we are already approved of by Father God, who loves us, who cares for us. We are loved by a God who does not change his mind based on what is perceived to be the latest trend or popular. A God who calls us friend. And his son, Jesus Christ, who comes to us, picks us up, and holds us close when we need it most. Much like in this picture of Jesus holding the lamb. So let's take time and pray. Lord, I thank you for your kindness, your goodness, your mercy, your grace. I thank you that you are always available for us. You are there to meet our every need. Renew us and refresh us, dear Lord. And Lord, I thank you that because you are our good shepherd, you want the best for us, we are always safe to come to you. We never need to worry about what you are going to think of us because you love us unconditionally. Father, I pray for any here who are hearing this that might be struggling to know that they are loved. Any that have not yet surrendered their life to you or accepted the invitation to come unto you, to be that shepherd, to be part of the flock. Move amongst us. In our hearts and in our lives. Help each of us to know that we are wanted, we are loved, we are welcome. Thank you, Lord God. So I'd invite you to join me now in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power forever and ever. Amen. There will be time for prayer here at the altar if you would like so. But now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Make the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace as you go forth and accept his invitation to walk with him as a lamb under the Lamb of God.